Instead of a homily today, I'm going to read an announcement. An announcement that I hope will not come as a complete surprise to us from things that have been saying over the past maybe 2 years, but an announcement still that is perhaps shocking. It's an announcement sent by Bishop Harris, written by Auxiliary Bishop Kennedy. He himself is making this announcement at Our Lady of the Miraculous Medal in the lookout, but Brian and I are reading it here in St. Mary's and St. Ignatius Martyr. This is the announcement. The administrator of Miraculous Medal Parish, Father Joseph Nixon, has been asked by Bishop Harris to accept a new priestly assignment as of June 26, 2019. Bishop Harris is pleased to announce that he will be appointing Father Brian Barr to serve as the new administrator of the parish as of that same day. Father Barr will continue to serve as pastor of St. Mary of the Isle in Long Beach. The appointment of Father Barr will initiate the pastoral planning process for all of our Long Beach Island. Each of the three parishes on the island will remain as they are now, but they will be linked under the leadership of Father Barr. In June 2020, upon the planned retirement of Monsignor Donald Beckman as pastor of St. Ignatius Martyr, Father Barr will be appointed as pastor to Miraculous Medal and to St. Ignatius Martyr. Bishop Harris has asked Father Barr to form special task forces in Miraculous Medal and St. Mary of the Isle. He has asked Monsignor Beckman to assist Father Barr in doing likewise in St. Ignatius Martyr. These task forces, consisting of leaders from each community, will assist in consulting parishioners in planning for mass schedules, sacramental services, and parish ministry. While this represents a significant change in the way that these parishes interact, it is also a moment for the Catholic leadership in these three parishes to increase efforts to evangelize Long Beach Island and call home those who may have drifted from the practice of the faith. That's the end of the announcement. Allow me to make a few comments by asking by answering what I suspect may be questions that any or all of you may have. Five of them. First, why does this have to happen? Why does this have to happen to us? My response is basically that we need to do the math. There are 135 parishes in the Diocese of Rockville Center. In no more than a few years' time, there will be 80 priests capable of being pastors of those parishes. That's 55 parishes that will not have a pastor. More than a third. It will be necessary for parishes to be the word used in other parts of the country is yoked together, not closed, remaining separate individual parishes, but sharing one pastor together. Second question might be, is that going to, as was intimated at least in the announcement, affect changes in mass schedules, indeed reduction of masses in each parish? And the answer is yes, it will. And those reductions will begin even this year, a year here, a year before I do retire. Right now, we have four priests on the barrier island, the three pastors and Father Anthony. When Father Nixon leaves, we'll go from four to three. That has to make a significant difference. We're not announcing right now, exactly which, what masses will change, what masses, how each parish will drop down the number of masses they have on both weekends and weekdays, because as Bishop Henning indicated, we hope to involve the members of the parishes in coming to some of those decisions. The third question you might ask, well, all right, so there will be fewer priests. Why can't they just do more masses? After all, what else will they do? Thank you for responding. We do have a few other things to do. Not only that, but there is a, as you know, in our church, canon law says that lay people may receive Holy Communion only once a day. It allows priests to celebrate Mass more than once a day, although that, when I was a child growing up, that was not the case. Masses were canceled even then, when there wasn't a priest to celebrate them. Every priest had to celebrate just one Mass a day. It's not that strict anymore. But the reality still is that we, like you, are only human. It's important for us to continue to have a deep devotion to the Eucharist, to be able to celebrate it with fidelity, with integrity, and quite frankly, if we end up becoming Mass machines, celebrating Mass after Mass after Mass after Mass, simply to allow schedules to remain the same, that would become spiritually destructive for us. That can't continue. Fourth question, well, why can't we get other priests from somewhere else? Why can't we bring in more international priests? Why can't we start ordaining married men? Why can't we start ordaining women? We've been very blessed to have Father Anthony with us. But he does not represent a huge number of priests from outside our country who are simply waiting for the opportunity of coming here. Indeed, the Holy See just a few years back told the bishops of the United States that we're already taking in more priests than the mission countries can let go of. Yes, they're, frankly, the bishops are willing to let them go because they don't have the funds to be able to support them. But they're needed there. They're needed where they can respond to the people of their own culture, to the people of their own languages. It's not possible for us just to keep stealing priests from other countries in order to keep our schedules the same. In the same way, there will, I suspect, someday be married men in the priesthood. Some of us may agree with that, some of us may not agree with that. But even if it is to happen, it's not going to solve our problems for quite some time. As far as ordaining women to the priesthood, Pope John Paul was very strong in saying that this is clearly against the will of Jesus. Pope Benedict XVI re-echoed that. I find myself standing with Pope Francis who is saying, we're just not ready to touch that at this point. And quite frankly, if I were to touch that at this point, I would end up leaving here much sooner than The fifth question, I'm a little reticent to raise because I don't particularly like talking about myself, but a number of you, when we had to announce a few weeks back that Sister Diane was elected to leadership in our congregation and would be leaving us, a number of you were kind enough to come up to me and say, well, that means now you can't retire. You've got to stay with us. We've got to have at least one of the two of you still here. I was very grateful for that affirmation. But at the same time, in June of 2020, I will only be a few months away from turning 76. I wonder how many of you continue to work full-time positions at 76. I will have been ordained priest for 50 years. I'll be inviting you to celebrate with me my 50th anniversary in May of 2020. And I just find that I don't have the living vigor that I used to have. Got 5 stents in my coronary arteries, and it's all too obvious to everyone as I try to get up and down the stairs how my arthritis continues to worsen. So it's not going to be fair to you for me to try to hang on. I also found just this past week that I had to apologize to our parish secretary because I snapped at her for an inconsequential thing. She was gracious enough to accept my apology. But I found myself thinking, you know, the longer it takes me to do things, the less strength I have to do things, the more pressure I put on myself. And I don't want you to be saying 2 years from now, you know, you still got the same pastor, it was just a draggy old man. That has to change. It's going to be necessary for me to retire in a year and 2 months. This will not be an easy transition for any of us. It will be a challenge. But it does, as Bishop Penny intimates at the end of the announcement, it does offer, I think, an opportunity for us as a community to enter more deeply into that exercise of lay leadership that the Second Vatican Council so strongly promoted, but that has faced real resistance in much of the leadership, clerical leadership of our church over the years. This is your parish. This will be an opportunity, I think, for you more and more to take that responsibility and take that leadership. Finally, let me just say that this is Christ's church. It doesn't belong to the clergy. It doesn't ultimately belong to the laity. It belongs to Christ. We must continue to pray that he will continue to send his Spirit to help us through this time of transition.